Hi, I'm Joel Meissner. I'm the systems engineer for Orcas Power and Light. As part of my job, I watch over the grid. Our grid consists of both transmission and distribution. We have approximately 49 miles, actually, of transmission, high voltage, 69 kV. And then we have about 1,350 miles of distribution cables. Transmission cables come across to us from Bonneville Power Administration.
In around 2000, BPA was conducting a project to install a new submarine cable with an add fibers, and there were some spare fibers in that cable, so we got the opportunity to lease those fibers, and we decided to take that opportunity, and it's been a great asset for us ever since. And
the importance of the submarine cables and the fiber connection is, you know, we're really trying to protect an asset. What the fiber really allows us to do with the submarine cables is keep those cables monitored on a cycle-by-cycle basis.
It's imperative that we take it from the manual kind of grid that we have right now, connecting fiber to our substations, and really expanding that those devices out into the field. The more of those devices that we connect out, we can monitor voltage, we can actually fine-tune our voltage and save on our power cost. We can actually do predictive devices if we connect the fiber out into the field. And when we do that, it gives us the capability to monitor out into the field the feeder sizes. We can actually delay some of the capital investments because we'll know that those feeders are either well served or we know that they need to be repaired sooner rather than later.
We have an excellent system and our grid is in great shape, but this communication system that we've built is limited at this point, and it needs to continue to expand. This expansion is going to allow for us to control and monitor so much more in a way that people haven't really thought of yet now. It's going to allow us to automatically switch devices. It's going to allow us to automatically monitor and control the power that comes to all the members' homes, such that they get a very high quality of power, a very high reliability, and we can do that as safe as possible with minimal interaction of personnel in a hazardous situation.
We need to design a comprehensive communication system that allows a self-healing grid. A self-healing grid really comes into play if we have opening and closing devices, and if we have a tree, for instance, going in a line in a over on Shaw, I'll use that as an example. We had one this year, and really we had about 3,000 people were out because of a tree knocked down a power line system.
We could, within a short duration of time, have the grocery stores, the schools, and the medical centers back in power without having to deploy people and deploy extra equipment or to even do any manual switching. The grid would know to do this stuff. It would be pre-programmed to do to accomplish these things.
The grid of the future needs to be modernized. When we connect those devices together, what do we do today? Today, what we need to do is build a platform that we can use tomorrow.
The smartest thing we can do today is to continue to build out our communications infrastructure so that we're prepared for what tomorrow has and the technologies that we'll be able to use.
I'd say the future of the electric grid is actually going to change from being a provider of power to be a servicer of power. We need to help our membership embrace whatever technology they have.
Today's grid is seeing more and more intermittent resources, solar, wind, tidal, these types of generation points that will add resources to us, but at the same time they can't stand alone. And so this type of grid is going to allow us to monitor and control the power flows throughout the system to make sure that everything's stable and everybody gets the appropriate power quality they need to run their daily lives, to work and live in this tough community.